Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Donna Coleman, Vice President, Norfolk and Portsmouth Beltline Railroad, and Chairman of Connections 2016.
And thank you for attending the 96th Annual Convention and the 103rd year of the American Short Line and Regional Railroad Association. Now please direct your attention to the screens and our safety briefing.
Welcome to the Maryland Ballroom of the Gaylord National Harbor Hotel. I'm Gary Vaughn, Chairman of the Safety and Training Committee, and here's a few safety tips for you to remember during your convention.
When entering, exiting, or walking about the room, please look for and step clear of any tripping hazards. In the event of an emergency, an ASLRRA staff member will pick up a wall phone, which will automatically connect to the front desk. The operator will be provided with the nature of the emergency, and a request will be made to security. In the case that an evacuation of the hotel is necessary, you will exit the room through the doors you entered, make a right, and follow the hallway through the glass doors, exiting the building at the Maryland Loop. You will then be between the hotel and the parking garage.
No emergency tests are scheduled for today. Will those certified to perform CPR please stand? Please note who those individuals are. The ASLRRA owns an automatic defibrillator and it is here at the tech table. The ASLRRA staff are trained in the use of the AED as well as the hotel staff. Please be seated. If there are any people in the room with special needs, please notify an ASLRRA staff member.
Please silence or put your mobile device on vibrate. Thank you.
No special safety gear is required today, and there are no significant weather events expected. However, if you go outside, be sure you talk to the front desk to be sure there's nothing expected. And remember, if you see something unusual, say something. Thank you and have a great convention.
Good afternoon. Connections is quite simply the very best event you will participate in this year. Focus solely on your needs. To get the most out of the 40 educational sessions, the exhibit hall with a record 255 vendors, general sessions, social activities, and committee meetings, I have three simple challenges for you. One, get to know someone new here. That'll be valuable to your personal or professional network. There's over 1,500 people to choose from. I think you'll find someone. If this is your first Connections, please stand. Come on, I just saw you guys. Okay, now everybody has at least one target for meeting your goal. Give them a warm round of applause. Number two on the list, learn something new, something you will take back and apply in your business. And number three, have fun. Smile often, laugh out loud at least once. Now, if you're meeting these goals, I want you to tell us about it at #ASLRRA2016. Now, if you're like me and you have to ask, that's a Twitter hashtag. But I'm going to be checking on you throughout the conference on these challenges. So you stop me and share with me how you're doing. Your planning committee has worked hard on this event for the past year, and we hope that you've been having a great time so far. In addition to all the volunteer labor that goes into this event, a convention of this magnitude cannot happen without a great deal of sponsorship support from our valued ASLRRA members. You'll see sponsor logos and names on various screens and signage throughout the convention. Please make note of them. And if you see a sponsor, please thank them and remember their generosity throughout the year. Provide them an opportunity to serve your business. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage ASLRRA Chairman Ed McKechnie of Watco Companies. I want you to know that it's our time. You and me lead the same life. I want you to know that I'm on
your side. Well, good afternoon and welcome to Washington, D.C. for the 96th Annual Convention of the American Short Line and Regional Railroad Association. I'm excited you are here, and I believe our volunteers, staff, and experts have put together a great agenda for you. You will have opportunities to learn about the Short Line Safety Institute, hear from Charlie Cook, and hopefully be challenged in your thinking by some of the panels of industry experts we've pulled together. This year, we will also be actively communicating a message to each and every one of you about the critical priority in our industry, and that is safety. We were reminded of the importance of safety in our industry yesterday afternoon with the death of two Amtrak employees south of Philadelphia. I'd ask you to join me in a moment of silence in their memory. Thank you. We all need to believe that safety is a priority over every other competing interest, and we will continue to say that until we are blue in the face. We also need to be sure that we don't just say it, but we model that behavior in everything we do. This week, we will introduce to you the man we hired to help to head up our Short Line Safety Institute. Ron Hines will join us later in the week to talk about his vision for the Institute and to talk about what we have learned now that the Institute has graduated from a pilot phase to a full-time organization with its own board of directors and its own advisors. We have challenged the Institute team to never forget that it is also an outgrowth of everything we do to address safety in this industry, and that the success of the Institute relies on the full support and guidance of the Short Line Association. You can visit Ron and his team in the exhibition hall where the Institute has set up a booth. I'm sure you'll enjoy getting to know him and hope you will share your ideas with him. I also want to use this time to challenge everyone in this room to once again rise to the occasion to support the permanency of the 45G short line tax credit. Under the leadership of Jerry Vest from Genesee and Wyoming, the LPC team has been having serious and frank conversations with legislative leaders about the future of 45G. What they have told us is that the days of simply extending most tax credits is over. That's the bad news. The good news is that for tax credits that have broad support from members of Congress, a pathway may become available for the credit to become permanent, and no tax credit has more support than 45G. The strength of the tax credit is the unwavering support from our customers and the broad support from all corners of America and both sides of the political aisle, and the enduring support of shortliners everywhere. Our message that investing in the future of American short-line rail transportation is well supported among members of Congress, and that is truly because of the good work of so many of you in this room. The credit has never been extended until the fourth quarter of the year after it expires. So it makes sense that the bulk of our effort to make it permanent should come sometime next year when Congress returns to Washington after the August recess. But in the meantime, we have the opportunity to do two critical things that could give us the opportunity to position ourselves for success in 2017. One, this year we need the active engagement of short-line shippers sharing their support with members of Congress. During the first reauthorization in 2007, more than 1,000 customers joined in an effort we called Save Our Service to make the case to members of Congress that the short-line tax credit was vital to the transportation needs of their companies. We need to replicate that effort again in 2007 and again have at least 1,000 shippers supporting our efforts. The second is for you to continue to work with members of Congress and have them become co-sponsors of the bill that would make 45G permanent. Please support the efforts of our Legislative Policy Committee to make sure that we have a majority of members of Congress supporting our bill. Your active efforts in the next 18 months are what we are counting on to keep 45G as a permanent fixture in this industry. Again, I appreciate you taking the time to be here in Washington. We have a great staff here in DC and an amazing group of volunteers that conspire together each year to make this a truly productive and memorable event for the industry. This year we have over 1,500 railroad industry people with us, making this the largest exhibition we've had to date. So the makings are all here for a great event. During my time as chairman, I've had one real strong desire in regard to these events. I wanted to be sure that you were engaged and that you saw the value proposition of spending this time away from your day job in your home offices. Toward that end, we have a great program this week that we hope will engage you and educate you in ways that will build value in your individual organizations and collectively as an industry. You will see us using a new system in some of our general session programming that will allow you to weigh in with your thoughts and opinions on key matters of the day. This survey device was first used last year in our Small Railroad Summit. In a nutshell, it allowed participants to provide instant feedback to a series of questions by using remote control devices with aggregate answers flashed up on the big screen in real time. It was a great way to have a dialogue and learn from one another versus the traditional approach of a big audience all focused on a talking head. It will be a little different this year because we will ask you to use your cell phones, but I'm sure you'll get the hang of it. Just don't forget to bring your cell phones to the sessions, which is not always what we ask you to do. Finally, I want to thank Donna Coleman for her hard work and being this year's convention chair. Donna has worked very hard. Yeah, please. Donna has worked very hard, and I hope you enjoy the week. Thank you all very much for being here.
Thanks so much, Ed. It has certainly been a busy year for the association. To tell us more about the association and the goals for 2016, please welcome Linda Darr, president of ASLRRA. Sweet Caroline, your time's never seen so good. Good afternoon. Welcome to our 2016 annual meeting, and thank everyone for being here. We appreciate it so much. By latest count, and this is as of probably about 45 minutes ago, we had 1,517 people here, and there was a line at the desk. So thank you, another great crowd, and we appreciate all of you taking the time to be with us. Donna Coleman, our Dynamo Convention Chair, is overseeing the work here of nearly 100 short line volunteers that have been preparing for your arrival for months. So I know that they are very happy that you're here. I can assure you that they are going to go above and beyond the call of duty to take good care of you this week, along with our fearless Short Line Association staff. I want to thank all of you for your hard work. This is really, in many ways, the pinnacle of our year, and we try our best to make it a good show for all of you. We know that yours is not a simple task. It's not easy being a shortliner. You operate the most vulnerable infrastructure in the national railroad system, so you must spend heavily on capital improvements. You serve small shippers, so you must build volume one carload at a time. You compete with a heavily subsidized trucking industry, so your rates must be aggressively competitive. You partner with huge Class I railroads, so that your schedule, your equipment, and even your customers are not always going to be your own. But you make it work. In the face of these obstacles, you have built something that matters in the world of transportation. 550 short lines operating 50,000 miles of track, one out of every four cars moving over the national railroad system. Connections for tens of thousands of towns and businesses to that system. And our role at the Short Line Association is to help you be successful. We are responsible for leading your legislative efforts and assisting you with regulatory compliance, organizing industry meetings and providing informative and useful content for those meetings, making connections between suppliers and short line railroads, and providing answers when there is nowhere else to look. But I believe we also have a responsibility to help our industry to think about and to think ahead on issues that impact your business and issues that impact the future while you're doing your day job. That's our job. Especially as I have come to realize that your days are very long days. So first and above all, our issue is railroad safety. That's the one we think about the most. I list it first because I truly believe, as I know so many of you in this room do, that it deserves first place on any railroader's priority list. It's our priority at the Short Line Association, and it's why we stood up the Short Line Safety Institute. We didn't do it because it is politically correct. And it's not just happy talk. Safe railroading brings home people to their families and friends. Safe railroading keeps your people healthy and committed to your workplace. Safe railroading is at the core of each one of your company's reputations. Safety first isn't just a slogan. It's not only the right thing to do, it's also very good business. And it's becoming increasingly clear that it's a growing focus of regulators in Washington. And I don't expect that that is going to change anytime in the near future. And this can present a challenge for everyone in this room. And it's not because we don't care about safety, but because we care deeply about safety. And because we realize the stakes are high if we leave railroad safety in the hands of others who, though well-intentioned, may not necessarily grasp the complexity of the decisions that they're making that affect your businesses. So we need to show them the way in that regard. It's our job. We need to lead. And that includes being open to changing and challenging our assumptions when that's called for. Safety culture at a company is based on the assumptions and the beliefs of its workforce. Those assumptions and beliefs determine the way the workforce makes decisions. And leaders have a big influence in building those assumptions and beliefs. The railroad workforce looks to the actions of its leaders to show them that they will consistently put safety first among all other competing priorities. So the leaders in our industry need to light the way forward. In short, that means walking the walk, safety glasses and vests, seat belts, taking the time to do things right, even when we may be tired or in a hurry. If we don't do these things, but then ask it of our team members, we create a cycle of mistrust. And the first ingredient in a strong safety culture is trust. I suspect there remain some cynics who believe that railroading is inherently dangerous, that human error is inevitable, and that not much can be done about either of those conditions. But to the skeptics and the cynics, I would say, please give us a chance to show you otherwise. Make a good faith effort to help us make this work. We need to make this work. Our new Short Line Safety Institute is going to help us make this work. It will bring us past the happy talk, and it will actually make a difference so that even the smallest railroad can have the tools to have a superior safety culture. Our second issue is carload traffic. Carload traffic is the lifeblood of the short line industry. We take great pride in the fact that we have turned losers into winners by bringing carload traffic back to light density railroad lines. But this association cannot and should not play a role in your individual marketing efforts or in your negotiations with your Class 1 partners. But we can and should lead an effort to give you some of the tools needed to make your work as productive as possible. Some of these tools are ordinary and actually very practical. We're going to dig out the best examples of short lines and class ones working together to secure carload traffic, and in particular, to wrestle it away from trucks. We want every short line to get a good look at what works, what doesn't, and why. We're going to develop a checklist of actions Class 1s can institute to take advantage of the short line's ability to attract and build carload customers in their operating territories. But some of these tools that we need are about understanding future trends so that we are prepared when the future arrives. That requires a better and more specific dialogue with our Class 1 partners about the future of carload demand. This will help frame our thinking about car supply and car type, about investment in capacity to meet demand, and about things like location and functionality of transload and warehouse facilities. Some say maybe we can't predict the future, but the fact is the Class 1 railroads devote a lot of time and energy to thinking about the future. So how can we build our needs for growth into those Class 1 calculations in a way that grows the combined short line and Class 1 value proposition? The third issue is putting numbers to our narrative. We have a story that sells. Safety, energy efficiency, reduced highway congestion, rural reach, customer service, affordability, and so much. But in Washington, that narrative needs to be supported with numbers and with data. It needs to be because we are in competition for limited resources and because we need to provide context that encourages support for our issues. That requires a better job of collecting and analyzing our own data. How much traffic do short lines take off the highway, and how much does that save taxpayers and highway damage costs? How many individual farmers depend on short liners to serve their local grain elevator? How do our wage and benefit levels stack up against other industries? How much are we investing in our infrastructure? This is the kind of information that not only helps us to tell our story, but it's also critical business intelligence for each one of our enterprises. We began the data collection effort in 2015 in a project aimed specifically at providing information to support the extension of the 45G tax credit. Over 300 short lines responded to the survey, the highest response rate, actually, that we have ever received. The data covered the period from 2004, which was the year before the tax credit was enacted, through 2013. Through that effort, we learned that short line operating revenues grew 164%. And during that same period, short line infrastructure investment grew 128%. As a percentage of operating revenue, this investment has remained between 24 and 31%. We also learned that even when the recession was at its worst from 2008 to 2010, short lines maintained consistently high levels of investment, never falling below 27% of operating revenues. We learned that short line federal tax liability after application of 45G grew 64%. From 2004 to 2013. So clearly, the growth made possible by the tax credit helps generate more tax revenue and not less. And that's the story that we really need to tell. These findings help to show that we're making a real and meaningful contribution to the nation's transportation system, and that's the story we owe to legislators, to regulators, and to the public if we are to expect their support for permanency of this critical tax credit for our industry. But that requires all of your participation. If you're one of the 305 railroads that helped us with our survey, I want to thank you. If you're not, I'd like to encourage you, and I hope that you'll do that in the future. So let me wrap up with this. 2015 was a truly successful year in Washington for our association and for the short lines that we serve. We secured an extension of the 45G tax credit. We beat back two big truck amendments in the Congress. We joined with our Class 1 partners in extending the PTC deadline. We stood up the Short Line Safety Institute with additional funding, and we hired its new executive director. We gave our regional meetings a much-needed overhaul. We increased our membership to a record high. All of this and more was accomplished because you got in our boat and you rode as hard and as fast as you could. I owe more thank yous than time permits to our board of directors, to our volunteer committees, to our generous financial sponsors, to those who travel to Washington to promote our legislative agenda. But I want to conclude with the most well-deserved thank you to our chairman, Ed McKechnie, who ends his tenure at this annual meeting. For 15 years, Ed has devoted his time and his energy to this association. He has served as chairman of our Legislative Policy Committee, as vice chairman of our board, and for the last 3 years, he has been our chairman. And personally, he has, in turn, taught me, challenged me, and very often made me laugh. I believe we all owe him a tremendous debt of gratitude, and I know that I speak for the entire short line industry in thanking him for his service to our cause. With the help of Ed and so many more, the Short Line Association sits on an incredibly strong foundation. Our task is to build upon that foundation, to make it stronger, to make it more effective and more relevant to the work you do for your businesses each and every day. That is both a challenge and an opportunity. And I'm eager for the challenge, I'm thankful for the opportunity, and I'm grateful that so many will be doing so much to help us succeed in the years ahead. Thank you. Sarah Feinberg was confirmed as the Federal Railroad Administrator on October 28, 2015. Administrator Feinberg is the second woman to lead the agency. You're seeing a theme here, I trust. The second woman to lead the agency since its founding in 1966 and leads a staff of nearly 900 professionals in Washington, D.C. and 8 regional offices across the country. The FRA workforce develops and enforces rail safety regulations, manages a $20 billion rail investment portfolio, and oversees research and technology development programs. Prior to serving as FRA administrator, Ms. Feinberg served as chief of staff to the U.S. Secretary of Transportation. Prior to joining DOT, she held several key positions in policy and strategic communications. She served as director of corporate and strategic communications at Facebook, and as director of communications and business strategy at Bloomberg. Before that, she served in the White House as special assistant to the president and senior advisor to White House Chief of Staff Rahm Emanuel in the Obama administration. Prior to serving in the White House, Sarah served as communication director for the House Democratic Caucus and as national press secretary to former Senate Minority Leader Tom Daschle. Sarah was new on the scene at FRA as acting administrator just about a month or two after I came on board at the Short Line Association, so I can say that I have known her practically my whole railroad career. She has been enthusiastic about learning more about short lines, and she has spent time visiting a number of our member railroads to get a broader perspective on our issues and our challenges. Together, we visited the Maryland Midland, the Everett Railroad, and most recently, just a few days ago, we toured Pacific Harbor Lines. She is an articulate and dedicated champion for railroad safety. She's a strategic thinker and someone who has aimed for transparency in decision-making in her dealings with our industry. Personally, I have come to admire her for her work ethic and her frank and open demeanor and as a trusted and amiable travel partner. Please welcome to the stage, Sarah Feinberg.
Yes, they always play music about Here Comes the Sunshine when your regulator walks in. Thank you, Linda, for that warm introduction. Let me tell you, the Short Line Association is unbelievably lucky to have Linda as its leader. She is passionate, strategic, and such a strong advocate for all of you. And let me tell you, she is always on the case. Every time I see Linda, I have signed up for something else. Speaking at your conference, having dinner with your executives, visiting a short line railroad. Literally, I walked in about 20 minutes ago and she said, I just need to talk to you about PTC for a minute. So I have no doubt that I will be speaking about PTC to all of you sometime soon. And it is, I can't tell you how lucky you are as an association to have someone so dedicated to your mission. So it's good to be with you all today and spend some time sharing a few thoughts with you, but I thought I would start with a stark reminder of our greatest responsibility and our most important mission, which is, of course, safety. I spent yesterday in Chester, Pennsylvania, at the site of a tragic incident and one that took two precious lives. It was a devastating accident and one that has left a workforce and a management team and an entire company reeling. And it is yet another reminder of what ultimately brings us all together, because there is really nothing more important than our responsibility to each other and to our employees to keep each other safe. But for me, this event is also a chance to talk to you about what FRA is doing, not just to strengthen safety, but frankly, to help strengthen the short line railroads as well. Of course, this conference, as Linda mentioned, is not the only time FRA gets to spend with the short lines. Just in the last year, I've visited four different short lines in Maryland and Pennsylvania and California. And I've spent time with your leadership, I've visited your offices, I've gotten to know many of you. Our regional leadership has met with many of you as well. We've worked together to strengthen safety, to increase transparency, and to learn more about each other. And the more time we spend with all of you, the more we understand your business and your safety challenges, and the better able we are able to work with you to get to a place of zero accidents and zero injuries, which is, of course, the goal that we all share. Every day that passes, FRA and the short lines have a better understanding of each other, and I think we all agree that this will continue to lead to better safety outcomes. After all, this is not a new line of business for any of you. America's short line and regional railroads have been at the forefront of rail innovation dating all the way back to the early 19th century. Short lines set the foundation to connect rail lines that really allowed the entire mainland of the United States to be connected by rail. Today, America's 550 short line rail lines cover 30% of the total track in the country, and they serve one in every four rail cars. They employ nearly 25,000 people. Simply put, this country's rail network would not be able to function without short lines. You are small businesses that serve local communities, and you're a part of the fabric of those communities. You understand the responsibility of providing critical service to communities in the region, and the all-important responsibility of operating safely. Like so many small businesses, you exemplify the entrepreneurial spirit. You're challenged to constantly come up with new creative solutions to new challenges and new market forces. And you've met that challenge head on, time and time again. While other businesses sometimes struggle to adapt quickly, short lines excel at this. You meet your customers where they need you to meet them, and you do it safely. It's through my visits and talks with short lines that I hear about new and creative approaches to improving safety, unique ideas that inspire and excite my own staff and myself, because they're new ideas and they work, and we'd like to see other railroads adopt them. Frequently, we take ideas that we've learned from you, and we talk to Class 1s about them, and we talk to commuter railroads about them. Just one example, Pacific Harbor's kiosk approach. As Linda said, just last week, we were in California visiting Pacific Harbor Line. PHL had a kiosk made especially for them, which presents the player, or the employee, with a safety Q&A. During my visit there last week, I spent some time answering kiosk questions myself. The train master has crews play with the kiosk while they're waiting for him in his office. And I can tell you, it's fun to try to answer the questions, but it's also a very effective way of ensuring that everyone at PHL, from top to bottom, is always getting smart about safety. Now, this doesn't come as a surprise to the folks here. At the 2014 conference, PHL won several safety awards, including the President's Award for the most hours of injury-free operations and for maintaining the best safety rate among railroads with 250,000 to 500,000 man-hours worked. But it's just one example of the entrepreneurial spirit of short lines resulting in safety innovations. It's also an example that FRA is noticing and acknowledging in everything that you're doing. You may have heard me say before, but I'll say it again, FRA is always open to new ideas and new ways to tackle old safety challenges. And despite all of the great work that we're doing together, I know that not all is perfect, but that we can continue to get better. But we need your partnership, we need your ideas, we need your openness, and we need your hand out to talk to us about what more we can do to improve safety. I want to turn to regulations for a moment. I know some of you may feel that regulations and a lack of resources make it difficult to meet the very high safety standards that the FRA and, frankly, that you yourselves place on your railroads and your employees. Let me say as clearly and as strongly as I can, and I've said this before, FRA wants to be a partner in improving safety. We don't just want to swing an enforcement hammer. When we need to, we will. But we want to be a partner because it's an important part of our jobs. It's, in fact, the most important part of our job. Our mission is to keep people safe and to make the rail industry the safest that it has ever been. One example of ways we're trying to help is positive train control. It may not feel like we're helping sometimes, but we really are. Working with the Congress, we just announced this morning that a new $25 million package of funding is available to help implement PTC. We expect to announce another $199 million package specifically for commuter and short line railroads soon. I know this is a drop in the bucket. I know there's a long way to go. But this administration has made it clear to Congress year after year that more significant funding is needed. In the President's budget for the next fiscal year, we propose $1.25 billion, that's billion with a B, to assist you and commuters with implementation. And we've been requesting that funding for years. It's long been said that budgets are reflections of priorities. That is true when it comes to our budgets at home, the budgets we have to stick to when we run a business, but it's also true when it comes to the President's budget. Every year, it's a fight to get new funding into that budget. But getting PTC funding into this President's budget has not been a battle, because this administration knows how important it is to get the help to those who are working so hard to implement this technology. So please do take our budget as a message about our priorities. This is just one of the ways that we're demonstrating that this administration wants to be a true partner in making investments in technology that will make your work and the work of your employees as safe as it can be. And while we're on the topic of safety, I do want to spend a few moments on the Short Line Safety Institute. First, I want to congratulate Ron Hines on his appointment as the Institute's first executive director. As many of you know, Ron has more than 40 years of rail experience, including serving as FRA's director of the Office of Technical Oversight, where he led 12 technical divisions and chaired the FRA's safety board. Ron is a great choice to lead the Institute. I'd also like to acknowledge Michael Long, who is joining the Institute as Senior Safety and Operations Manager. Michael is also an FRA alum, serving 12 years in various positions. The Short Line Safety Institute is the result of a strong partnership between FRA, the Short Line Association, the University of Connecticut, and Volpe. We all came together in early 2014 to support the Institute's development and innovative plans to try to assist short lines in improving safety in an efficient and streamlined way. The Institute is already achieving that goal and improving all the time, visiting with more short lines, learning how to work closely with each individual railroad to improve safety. The Short Line Safety Institute focuses its work on four pillars of activities: safety culture assessment, education and training, research and evaluation, and strategic communications. It's a smart approach, and it's one that is paying dividends. It's hard to believe now that the Institute started out with a $500,000 grant in fiscal year 2014. It is now receiving more than $2 million in funding. FRA strongly believes that continued long-term congressional support for the Institute is critical to its success. I'd also like to discuss crew size. Now, I realize if there's one issue that can end a short line conference party quickly, it's probably the issue of crew size, but it is an important one. Last month, we proposed a rule to establish a baseline crew size and a safety review and approval process for railroads who want to transition to less than two-person operations. We understand that one-person crew operations are more common on short-line railroads and are indeed critical for keeping a railroad viable. With that in mind, FRA established exceptions in the proposed rule for railroads that operate at low speed or have few employees. We've also included relief for those railroads that do not meet exception but have operated with one-person crews before 2015. FRA feels that these exceptions will provide relief to most short-line one-person crew operations. If these exceptions described in the proposed rule do not work for your operation, then we want to hear from you. Read the draft rule carefully and provide us with your comments. The truly fundamental question addressed by the crew staffing rule is whether or not the federal government and the American public should have a voice as railroads make safety decisions as they transfer from two-person crews to one-person crews, or even, frankly, to fully automated crews or fully automated operations. The proposed rule would simply give FRA a seat at the table as railroading operations continue to evolve and as technologies like PTC are implemented and come online. We are willing to listen and find ways to work with you, not just on crew size, but on other regulations as well. Because as I stated earlier, our intent is not to force railroads into a one-size-fits-all solution with an enforcement hammer. The goal is to continue a dialogue between FRA and railroads about how we can work together to find solutions that both work for an individual railroad, but also achieve the goal of increased rail safety. The relationship between short lines and the FRA is a partnership, and as long as I am at FRA, we will continue to be your partner. Now, I know you have many exciting and informative panels and lineup of fantastic speakers, so I'll finish up my remarks and give you a chance to ask a few questions, if that's helpful. Before I conclude, I want to once again thank the Short Line and Regional Association for inviting me. Again, we very much view our relationship with the association as a partnership. We enjoy our work with you. We look forward to working with you going forward. Short lines are truly one of America's great small business success stories, and all of us in this room are committed to continuing that success. I look forward to spending my time as FRA administrator working in partnership with you. Thank you. And now I will stand up here awkwardly while I wait for Linda to come. You want me to take questions?
Yes.
Be happy to take some questions. Although, please know that it's hard to see, so.
Hi, can I get you to expand on the...
There we go. They turned the lights on.
Can I get you to expand on the financial assistance that you mentioned in your speech?
Yeah, so actually there are... there's a lot of new financial assistance becoming available this year and next year, much more than in previous years. Much of that is due to the FAST Act. Some of it is due to the budget. What I mentioned specifically in these remarks was a new package of funding that we announced this morning, which is $25 million in PTC assistance. So it's a grant program just like any other. So we've put out the notice of funding availability. That's out today. Everyone should take a look at it. It provides guidance on what we're looking for as we look through grant applications. Feel free to call us. We can give additional guidance. We can talk you through applications. There's There's really no limit on our ability to work with you to try to help you come up with a good application. Submit your application, and we will be providing grants to assist with PTC. Those grants will go out in the coming months. So keep in mind this is an election year, and so the administration really tries to complete the grant process early. So while we would normally sort of be working through the grant process throughout the year, this year we will be trying to get it done early, probably by the end of the summer. And so this is actually, there will be a quick turnaround on this. So that's the $25 million for PTC that was announced this morning. Later in the next couple weeks, maybe couple months, we'll be doing a notice of funding availability for a separate tranche, which is another $199 million, again, for PTC assistance. The Congress has specified that that should be specifically aimed at commuter railroads and short line and regional railroads. So that's another tranche of funding. And then additionally, there's other tranches that I didn't mention. There's new grade crossing money, there's freight programs. There's really huge opportunity this year and next year for new funding that wasn't available previously. The FRA has drafted a letter that will actually go to state departments of transportation to make sure that state departments are aware of the money that's available, particularly the new money. We can share that with any of you all. So as we complete that letter, I'll make sure that we share a copy with Linda and with the team here so that you really have a handy list of what's available. Hope that answers your question.
Well, I can ask one as a microphone holder.
We're curious about the liability study required by the FAST Act, and specifically which office is handling that and how do short lines participate?
The office that's handling it, it would be a team between both the safety office and our legal division, which we refer to as RCC. But we're more than happy to have a conversation with you. I've lost the questioner. We're more than happy to have a conversation with you and explain more and sort of talk about how we're thinking about it and provide some guidance if that's useful. That really goes for across the board, anything on the FAST Act or any programs that we're working on. You know, I kept hitting on that in my remarks that this is a partnership, this is a partnership, this is a partnership. It really is. Our door is open. You know, our phones ring right at our desk. Our emails come right to our computers, our iPhones. You know, we're here to answer questions. We don't want railroads to be functioning in the dark and to be wondering what we're thinking or what we're looking for. Call us, talk to Linda, ask Ed. You know, we want to be working with you. So those two offices are key, and we'd be happy to set up a conversation.
As far as grade crossing incidents and especially kind of an uptick on the trespasser incidents, mm-hmm. I know there's been a new website released from the FRA. Can you talk about that a little bit and how you're targeting that?
Sure. That's a new website that we released just about 2 weeks ago, and you can get to it right through our safety website, through our FRA safety page. And it's just an attempt to have a discussion about grade crossings and trespassers in a less policy wonky bureaucratic government form. And it's just an attempt to have a more basic conversation about do's and don'ts at crossings and general safety measures. You know, this has been something that we've been focused on tremendously at FRA over the last, well, for many, many years. There have been many really dedicated public servants and safety experts who have been focused on this for a long time, but particularly over the last year and a half or so. The first major accident that I dealt with as acting administrator was the Valhalla grade crossing accident that happened in New York. And the NTSB is still investigating that incident, and you know, I think that we'll probably know more soon. But I think it has made all of us at FRA try to think about grade crossing accidents in a new way. Here we are in 2016, and I just don't think we can fool ourselves anymore into thinking that a grade crossing is as simple as a driver approaching a grade crossing and seeing lights and gates and stopping and just waiting, because we've got iPhones and devices and mapping applications and distracted driving and folks who are traveling farther for work and farther to take their kids to school than they have, and they're in congestion and their commutes are taking longer, and there's a lot of incoming there. And I think we have to be really aware of drivers losing situational awareness and being distracted and not even realizing that they are approaching a crossing. So we're trying to think about it in a lot of different ways and provide a lot of really basic information that might help people understand how important this is.
Hello, thank you. You mentioned the current regulatory environment. Do you believe that the FRA is adequately staffed to handle oversight of increased regulations?
Well, it's an excellent question. Do I think we're adequately staffed? I think it probably depends on what it is that we're trying to work through and what stage of the process we're in. Every regulation requires a cost-benefit analysis for very good reason, obviously. It is a constant challenge to make sure that we have the resources that we need in terms of economists. So when you think of FRA, you probably don't think of a lot of economists working there. And frankly, if you're an economist, you're probably not thinking, I want to go work at FRA one day. So it's kind of a... it's a unique, and it's not unique to the government, but it's unique to, I think, both sides of the divide of transportation and economist. Especially if you're applying for a job in our regulatory workforce, I'd really like to talk to you because we're always looking for more help. I think the most important thing to understand about the regulatory environment is that it's not built for speed. And on all sides, there is a desire for us to move quickly, land quickly, make decisions quickly, get rules completed quickly, or determine that we're not going to complete a rule, that the regulation doesn't make sense, and to make that decision quickly. And, the regulatory system in the United States is pretty complicated for a pretty good reason. A lot of cost-benefit analysis goes into everything. There is many, many, many steps that a regulatory agency has to go through in order to finalize a regulation. And so it does not move quickly. There are many, many bars to get over and hoops to jump through. Sometimes I think we're well-staffed for it. Other times I think that we could use some help. But it's also the regulatory environment that every agency is dealing with at the moment.
Are there any more questions for Administrator Feinberg? Well, this has been fantastic. Thank you again.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Thank you. And a thank you to all of our tremendous speakers this afternoon. What a way to kick off this program. It's now time to welcome our exhibitors who are here to meet you. In about 45 minutes, please join us one level down at the entrance to the expo hall for our grand opening and reception. During the reception, we hope you will also take time to check out all the fabulous items we have for the silent auction. And if you've not purchased a locomotive for the second annual Pinewood Derby, it's not too late. You really don't want to miss this. Thank you all for your attention this afternoon.